Dear learners, welcome to the EPG Pathshala, and we are going to discuss today about a very important aspect of local self-governance and decentralization planning in India. It is part of the rural development course. I am Dr. Chandrakant Puri. I am chair professor of Rajiv Gandhi Center for Contemporary Studies of the University of Mumbai, and also the board of studies chairperson for rural development at Mumbai University. You will be looking at the following objectives today in this particular module. What we are going to do is that we are going to first look at what the local self-governance is. We will try to define it. We will also look at the decentralized planning in India. And the second objective of this module will be to explain the history of local self-governance and decentralized planning, because this will be sort of an overview as to how we have entered into the local self-governance and decentralized planning in our country. If you look at the history of India, you will find that there is always an emphasis on having some kind of a local governance. If you look at the history, some of the scriptures, they talk about how these communities were self-sufficient in terms of planning. And whether it is a tribal area, you will find that a greater history of local self-governance in tribal areas, because they were anyway locally self-governed people. Also, the similar thing you will find in rural areas, and later on, as people moved from rural tribal to urban areas, you will find that there is also some sort of governance there. So you will also see that every community which is there has to have some kind of a governance. And so this module will look at what is the structure, what is this local self-governance, and what are the bodies which are existed in several of these communities and localities that we are talking about. Let us now see what is local self-governance means. We will try to define these local self-governments. According to Aslam, the meaning of local self-governance is a government run by local people, which is concerned with the local issues, where all the local people can participate in all the concerns and functions of the government. What he is emphasizing is about having some kind of a body, some kind of a structure, which is concerned about the local issues. And who are the people who are involved? It is the local people, because unless you have local people governing themselves, the issues that people are concerned with will not be resolved. And that is the emphasis that Aslam has given. And hence, the local self-governance advocates the accountability and efficiency to improve the local level concerns. And when we say advocacy, we are talking about people themselves talking about their issues, and also part and parcel of this entire process of resolving the issues at the grassroots level. According to Hari Nagarajan and others, they have also tried to define decentralization. According to them, decentralization, as is generally understood, implies devolution of powers to the local bodies that are separated from the central government. This is a very important aspect, I think, because you will find that it is only because of the 73rd and 74th Amendment the powers have been devolved. It has been given to the people. And that's the reason the emphasis here is to have local planning done by the people at the grassroots level, and thereby not having a central centrality of power. It is a decentralization of power. That's what we are talking about. And these local bodies are headed by representatives who are elected by a formally constituent electoral processes. This is another important aspect, because you will find that there were a lot of issues in rural areas. Usually you will find that those who are powerful were only heading the local issues, and you will also find that there is a very interesting correlation between the class and caste and also gender. So you will find that those who were dominant, they were heading the local panchayats. But it's only because of the 73rd Amendment, it is people are re-elected, and they are democratically elected, and that is what is the emphasis of this particular aspect is. Now, if you look at the decentralization, it is a political process whereby administrative authority public resources and responsibilities are transferred from central government to agencies at the local level. If you look at the structure at the 73rd amendment, you will have Gram Panchayat, which becomes a very, very important unit. Then you have Panchayat Samiti, and third is Jilla Parishad. This is we call as three-tier system. And you, if what is happening in this is, this administrative authority, there are public resources. I mean, if you look at the act, you will find that there are certain public resources where the ownership and control is with the local bodies. And of course, the responsibilities are also raised with the people at the grassroots level. And that is a very, very important aspect that Crook and Manohar has explained in their work. Broadly, decentralization refers to transfer of political, administrative and fiscal responsibilities to the level, local level unit. And that is, I think, is the overview of the local self-governance when we talk about decentralization. Now, let us look at the history, how it has evolved. You know, it has not become a reality in one day. And there is a huge history to it. If you look at the historically, all the scriptures, they do talk about the fact that there was a self-governance, and that was in a different way. I mean, if you look at the local self-governance of tribal people, they had a different structure altogether. If you look at the rural, they had their own structure. And urban, of course, it is amalgamation of both, you know, sometimes existed, sometimes did not exist, but it is only because of the 74th amendment, it has got a very, very formal structure. So, this is what we see when it comes to the original, I mean, the text that when we refer, and it talks about the ancient India. In fact, if you look at the Sangha concept of Buddha, it talks about the same thing, you know, having some kind of a body which will govern their day-to-day activities. Second aspect is about the medieval, because this is where there was a lot of change in terms of structure, because but again, emphasis here again was there was not much change as such, because though they tried to do some kind of a changes in terms of collection of revenue and all that, but not much change has happened during the medieval period. The changes happened basically when the Britishers came, because Britishers had their own understanding, they had their own history of governance, and they wanted India also to have that kind of a structure. So you will find that little bit changes that has happened were basically in the British period. And Mahatma Gandhi, father of the nation that we call him, was very much concerned about the local governance. He always had a full faith in village panchayat system. He felt that people themselves can govern themselves better than somebody else coming. So if you look at this entire concept of Gram Swaraj, it talks about managing day-to-day affairs by the people, for the people, of the people. And that is the kind of concept Gram Swaraj has. And there he was saying that this has to have a very, very important aspect of governance. Then you will also find that he also was against the concept of having top to bottom approach. It is he who said that, you know, the people who are living in the villages should govern themselves. So the process of planning should start from grassroots. And another very important aspect which he talked about was strengthening of village panchayats, because he felt that being a first very important unit of democracy, it is panchayat who should be able to have their own say when it comes to ruling themselves. And that's the reason he said that if you want to make these villages vibrant, you must make sure that it existed. He also talked about all-inclusive grassroots democracy. I think this is very, very important aspect of Gandhiji, wherein he expected that there will be people who will take care of each others, there will be no one who will be left out of this entire process, and that's the reason he felt that being a very important and the first unit of democracy, this needs to be strengthened. There were several committees Before we came to the 73rd and 74th amendment formally becoming, as a formality, there were several committees, and we will look at those committees now. The first and very important committee which came in 1957 was Balwant Rai Mehta Committee. And this committee felt that development cannot progress without responsibility and power. So if you want development, you must give responsibility to people and also give power to the people. Second aspect of Mehta Committee was that community development can be real only when the community understands its problems and realizes its responsibility. So it is, if you want to understand what the problem is, go to the people, try to understand what people want, and then also give them the responsibility, because they are the one who can resolve these issues. And third very important aspect of Mehta Committee was that necessary power through its representative should be given, and they should maintain a constant and intelligent vigilance on local administration, because this was a time when you will find that the administration was maintained by so-called centralized way. So he was talking about decentralization. And then during 1959 and 64, there were also some kind of development wherein Panchayati Raj system in India was very well developed in states like Andhra Pradesh and Rajasthan. These were the first state to have a Panchayati Raj in a formal way coming up. And then there were other states which also adopted the system, but problem is that there was no uniformity. I mean, some states were talking about three-tier system, some states were talking about two-tier system. So it is that this is a time when a lot of reviews were taken, and they felt that can we have some kind of a unique model, and that is why later on you will find that the three-tier system has come in. So this was the change during the 1959 and 64. Another very very important committees came up, and there were two important committees. First committee was Ashok Mehta Committee in 1977, and he was appointed because this was a very important aspect wherein this committee analyzed and recognized the nuance of earlier committees and suggested the further route. I mean, there was some kind of a concrete structure which took place during this time. The second committee was G.V.K. Rao Committee, and he was appointed by the Planning Commission, because I think Planning Commission also wanted to take a very very strong view of the local governance, and this committee was appointed with to review the existing administrative arrangements for rural development and poverty alleviation programs, and to recommend appropriate structural mechanism. This is also the time when a lot of changes were happening in terms of rural development program. So this committee became very important. In 1986, Government of India again set up a committee headed by L.M. Singhvi to prepare a concept paper on revitalization of Panchayati Raj institutions. I think here a lot of brainstorming has taken place as to which structure that we go for, what should be the scope of the local governance and all that. So this big committee becomes a very very important. There were also few more committees and commissions which were talking about the same aspect as to what way we should proceed and what should be the structure and all that. And that is how I think this later on, the 73rd, 74th amendment which came, all these committees and commissions played a very very important role in order to lay foundation for the 73rd and 74th Act of Parliament. So you will find through this history that how important it was to have committees, commissions, and also some study groups, including some of the study groups appointed by the Government of India and Planning Commission, which led to a very important aspect of 73rd and 74th Amendment. And I think in the next module, we are going to discuss in detail what were the features of the local self-governance in terms of 73rd and 74th Amendment. But if you look at the 73rd Amendment, it is a very important aspect, because it is on the backdrop of the globalization, liberalization, and privatization. These things, I mean, the country was changing, and we also had to decide as to in what direction that we take our local self-governance. Then also, there was a need to have a comprehensive change in the local self-governance, and that is what happened in the year 1992-93 with the 73rd and 74th Amendment. So this is in brief about this module. I'm sure you will be able to understand the history of it. You will also be able to write the history of the Panchayati Raj institutions. You will also look at the important milestones in the development of the 73rd and 74th Amendment. And in the next module, we are going to look at very, very important aspect of this module, which is called the 73rd and 74th Amendment, and we will look at what are the provisions of 73rd and 74th Amendment. Wish you all the best. Do refer to the e-content that we have developed. Also look at, there are several videos on YouTube. There are also books written by several people. Of course, we have given the reference list with this e-content. Please have a look at it, and happy reading to all of you. So we have discussed in detail the background of the 73rd and 74th Amendment. Now we will look at what are the salient features of the 73rd and 74th Amendment. We will also look at the PESA Act, which is a very, very important, and also we will look at the 6th schedule, which talks about the governance in the tribal area. So this aspect will be covered into this particular module. Let us look at the 73rd and 74th module now. Panchayats and municipalities, I mean panchayats, when we talk about, we are talking about the village. We are talking about municipalities in terms of urban governance. So panchayats and municipalities will be institutions of self-government. It's a very clearly mentioned in the Act. Basic units of the democratic system is Gram Sabha, which is a very, very important, and the ward committees, comprising of all the adult members registered as voters. I mean, this is very important aspect, because when it comes to pushing certain agenda for development, we can, as members of the Gram Sabha or ward committees, we have right to go and talk about our concerns in the Gram Sabhas and the ward committees, and that I think has been given as an important right in this Act. Another important aspect of this is three-tier system of panchayats at village level, which is village, block and district level. Of course, there are certain restrictions in terms of state with population is below 20 lakhs, this is not applicable. But otherwise, you will find that these three important aspects at the panchayat level, block level and district level play a very, very important role, because whatever concerns are expressed at the panchayat level, they are supposed to be taken up at the taluka level, with the representatives available there, and also at the district level, because planning which takes place at the district level also has to percolate, and it is like both way. I mean, village level concerns should go to the district level concerns should also come at the village level. This is also another very important features of the 73rd Amendment. Then you also have other very important provisions, and those are like direct elections. Till now, before this amendment could come, there were no regular elections. Many a times the seats were nominated, there were a lot of issues with that. So this is formalized now because of this Act, and you will find that every state has to have a state election commission. So direct elections have taken place. Then seats are reserved for the marginalized communities like scheduled caste and scheduled tribes, and not only representation at the Gram Panchayat level, but also this is happening at all three tier levels. as a result, what happens is that the participation of the scheduled caste and scheduled tribes also has risen considerably. It is not only confined to just a member. A very important aspect of this is that chairperson of the panchayat at all levels also reserved for the scheduled caste and scheduled tribes. And that's the reason you will find that first time we saw the scheduled caste or scheduled tribe representative becoming head of all the three tiers, whether it is a Gram Panchayat, Panchayat Samiti or the districts level. And I think this is a very historic kind of achievement. It happened only because of the 73rd Amendment. Another is a very important aspect is that reservation of women. Till now, women were not given the formal representations, and as a result, if you look at the data from the pre-Panchayati Raj and the post-Panchayati Raj, you will find there is a huge difference. Now, 1/3 of the seats are reserved for scheduled caste and scheduled tribe women. In fact, if you look at the recent development, states like Kerala and Maharashtra, they have gone ahead and said that now, since women's percentage population is equivalent, so why not have 50% reservations for women? And that's a reason I think these states have become pioneers in increasing the women's representation to 50% level. This only happened because there is a provision in the scheduled caste and scheduled tribe communities and also their representatives. Another very important aspect is that wherever you find that there is a representation of the marginalized communities, that is scheduled caste, scheduled tribe or women, the concerns of the marginalized have been expressed, and they have been highlighted in the bodies, and they accordingly decisions were taken. So in a way, what Gandhiji wanted, the antyodaya, the development of the last person, has been achieved because there is a representation to all these communities. Then you also have term in terms of elections. Every person will get 5 years term for the election, and these elections are to be taken after before the expiry of the term. And as I mentioned earlier, there are also election commissions who are supposed to make sure that before even the expiry of the present body, the new body should get elected and they should continue their activity. And in case if there are any problems in terms of dissolution or other problems, then it is also compulsory for the election commission to conduct the elections within 6 months of the problem that something like a dissolution takes place. So the objective behind this is that no seat should be vacant. At all levels you will find that proportion to population, whatever seats are available, they should be filled in by the government. Independent election commission each state is another feature of the 73rd amendment, and I think this is also a very important aspect of our democracy, saying that election commissions are independent. They have no control of the state on them, so they are free to schedule their elections according to the requirement and as per the law. They are also free to decide the reservation in terms of which wards or which the constituencies should go for which community and all that. But there have been a lot of problems in this particular area, and state commission, election commission takes a very serious view of this, and they conduct the elections in a fair manner. Another very important thing is that panchayats are supposed to prepare plans for economic development and social justice in respect of subjects as devolved by law. And that is happening at all levels. So you will find that the plans are prepared based on the requirement of the communities. It is not that some government administrator will come and say that, okay, this is the development plan. It is the plan by the people, because it is for them, and hence the important aspect of planning at the grassroots level has been taken place, and it is only because of the 73rd provisions in the 73rd amendment that we have seen. Then we have district planning committee, that is at the which consolidates the plan prepared by the panchayats and municipalities. This is for both 73rd and 74th amendment. Why you need to have a district planning committee is because it can decide what are the concerns of the district in terms of development. And you will again find that the district planning committee has representations of people, and that is that makes the district planning committee also democratic. Of course, there are also administrators and others who are member of this district planning committee. And then regarding funds, which is a very, very important aspect to run the local self-governance, and you will find that there are budgetary allocations from state governments, and there are certain arrangements of sharing revenue and certain taxes. Otherwise, how will the gram panchayats and other bodies function? So collection and retention of revenue is also very, very important program. Also, you will also have a lot of funds coming in from the central government program through grants. There is also Union Finance Commission, which also gives grants to the local bodies. And this is how it helps the local bodies to function efficiently, because unless you have funds, you cannot function. So funds are also provided by law. Another important aspect is the Finance Commission in each state. And this Finance Commission is very important, because every state can determine the principles on the basis of which adequate financial resources would be ensured for the panchayats and municipalities. And if you look at the kind of critique which is coming in, is that the government has to be more proactive in terms of providing funds. And I think that is one aspect wherein again the elected representatives are now asking for more funds, and also asking Finance Commission to be more proactive. Now let us look at the local governance at the six scheduled areas. There are certain areas like Assam, Meghalaya, Tripura and Mizoram, which are tribal dominated areas. And for them, they have got a special provisions under the sixth schedule. And this sixth schedule is very, very important, because there are very important provisions which we will look at one by one. First thing is that if there are different scheduled tribes in an autonomous district, the governor may, by public notification, divide the area of areas inhabited by them into autonomous regions. Because you will find that some of the tribes are very, very small in size, and in order to have their own development, it is very difficult to have ensure the development. So what governor can do is that governor can decide a particular area as special area and give autonomous region status. And this is very, very important, because a lot of these primitive tribes and other very important tribes have got benefited only because they have got this autonomy. Second very important aspect of this is that governor has a power by public notification to include any area in any of the parts of the said table. They have to prepare a table, and also exclude any area from any of the parts of the table that they have. So you will find that the governor plays a very, very important role, and government does this based on the representations from the people, also administrative experiences, because you will find that certain communities which are very small in number, if they are not getting developed, then it is a responsibility of the governor to make sure that the tribals are taken care of, because he is a representative of the President of India in the state. So he has to ensure that the development and equal development should take place of all the communities. And that's the reason this provision has been made in the six scheduled areas. Governor can also create a new autonomous district if he desires, again based on the data, the population and other aspects that I have mentioned earlier. He can also increase the areas of any autonomous district. Suppose if he finds that certain areas are spread over two districts, but they have similarity in terms of culture, the kind of backwardness they have, the development needs. So you can decide that even other areas can be included into the autonomous district. He can also diminish the area of any autonomous district. That also special power has been given by the Sixth Schedule. So similarly, you will find that there are a lot of provisions into the provision. I think it will be very interesting to look at the original document of the Sixth Schedule, which is available on the internet, and I would urge all the learners to go and study in detail what are the provisions made in this particular Sixth Schedule areas. Let us now look at a very, very important aspect of Fifth Schedule areas. The Parliament enacted the Panchayats, that is called PESA. It is called Panchayats to Schedule Areas Act, PESA 1996. This is a very important and historic decision by the Government of India, because of the Fifth Schedule areas and the PESA Act, a lot of important decisions were taken in terms of tribal communities. Let us look at the key provisions has been made in this particular act. One thing is that this act provides autonomous powers to the Gram Sabhas to protect the and preserve tradition of their people and community resources. You will see that villages like Mendaleka in Gadchiroli, they have become self-reliant and they had a control over all the local resources, and as a result you will find that has become ideal village. So it is possible only because we have a PESA Act. So lot of the tribal areas which are dominated tribal areas have provisions of PESA, and as a result you will find that lot of the tribal communities are able to have better control over their resources, and as a result you will find that they are doing well in terms of development. This act also has several other provisions like mandatory executive functions to approve plans of the village panchayats, identify beneficiaries for scheme, issue certificates of utilization of funds. This is a very important thing because I think these executive powers that they have, they become very, very important. As a result, they are able to actually plan their own development at the village level and also identify beneficiaries, and it is the people who decide beneficiaries collectively. There is no control by others, and that becomes a very, very important thing. There is another provision is that they have right to mandatory consultation in matters of land acquisition, resettlement and rehabilitation, and are prospecting licenses, mining lease for minor minerals. This important provision has been made in this act. It's because you will find that a lot of the tribal areas, they have resources, and these resources belonging to the people of that area. Many incidences we saw in past that though villages were existed, the tribal areas were existed, they had no control on the resources in their area. And that's the reason, whether it is acquisition of land, it is compulsory for the bodies to take consultation of the people into the PESA area. They also have power to prevent alienation of land and restore alienated land. So if government has taken the land, it is people who can decide that, you know, they are not interested in giving that land, and they can restore the land. It is the village, it is the Gram Sabha which has this kind of a provision. They also have power to regulate and restrict sale or consumption of liquor. Several of the tribal areas have enacted this particular provision, and they have become ideal villages because they could restrict the sale and consumption of liquor, which is an important aspect of development, because you will find that in tribal areas, consumption of liquor is one of the major problems. You also have power to manage village markets, control money lending to scheduled tribes. This also is because there is a history to this kind of a problem, and that's the reason this provision has been made. Ownership of minor forest produce. Earlier you will find that the tribals were not even given the entry to the forest areas. With this particular act, now people have ownership, not only entry, But ownership of minor forest produce, and they can go to the forest areas and take a benefit of the minor forest produce, and they can sell the minor forest produces also, which becomes a very, very important aspect of their livelihood traditionally. And that's the reason this aspect is very, very important. You also have power to control institutions and functionaries in all the social sectors. This is, I think, another very historical kind of a component which has been given in this. And power to control local plans and resources for planning the tribal sub-plan. And this tribal sub-plans is very, very important, because tribal sub-plan is a very, very important aspect of tribal development. Earlier, people had no control on this, but now because of this, people are able to have control on the local plans also, which becomes a very, very important aspect for their development. So, you will find that we have seen very important aspects. First aspect we have looked at is about the historical development of Panchayati Raj. We have looked at the definitions given by different people. We also look at the salient features of this 74th and 73rd amendment. We have looked at what are the provisions into the six schedule areas, and we have looked at how special powers have been given by the state to the governor in order to make this very, very important aspect for the tribal self-rule. Another very, very important aspect we have looked at is the PESA Act and various provisions in that, and you will find that whether it is six schedule areas or the PESA, they have become a very, very historic kind of a development in the history of tribal development, and adequate powers have been given to the people themselves who can use this particular PESA and six schedule areas Act and make sure that the development is happening as per their requirement. I think if you look at the entire module, this module gives us an understanding that what system of local self-governance which existed in the ancient India, it's continued formally with the introduction of the 73rd and 74th area. Whatever flaws we feel that were there in the 73rd and 74th amendment have been taken care of by the 6th schedule and the 5th schedule areas, and that's the reason it is, in terms of development, you can call it as a people's development. And I think if you use these provisions, it is very, very essential for the people to make ensure that their development takes place. With this, we stop here in this module. As I referred earlier, please go through several books which are available. We have given in the e-content all the references. We have also given web resources. There are good case studies of the certain provisions of these, like PESA, and there is a nice documentary on the Mendhaleka village in Maharashtra, which has shown that using the PESA, how a tribal village can become the self-sufficient. So I would request all of you to use these e-resources which are available on the internet and enhance your learning. Wish you all the best.